In fact, the secondary IOLs as well as the polysaccharide of the piggyback IOLs, they have been helping us to overcome all the problems with aphakia and high refractive errors and post cataract surgery refractive surprises. So these are the various secondary IOLs that are in, we have been using. But the achieving emmetropy in all these cases is still a bugbear. We may not be able to hit the bullseye, but so let's see. I would like to share my way of what I'm following to achieve refractive emmetropy. So we know about this. I will not go into much of these details. The ELP is nothing but distance between the corneal plane and then the lens. The whole thing is considered as a thin plane. So in case the IOL is shifted from here, this is in the bag, towards the cornea, the ELP changes. Along with that, the refractive power also changes. So same lens will become stronger. It may throw in surprises. So you have to keep this in mind. And accordingly, see, this is another example. In the bag, it comes to about 5.489. And when you shift it to sulcus, the ELP is this much. And the change is around 0.566. So with this, the IOL power also changes. So that's why it becomes relevant when doing the secondary IOL power calculation. Basically, IOL power can be calculated based on the axial length using the Vergence formula or the refractive error using the Vergence formula. Axial length, these are the various formulas that are used, and the Barrett 2 now is giving more or less accurate results, but one need these details, axial length, keratometry, and then of course the constants, IOL constant. Then refractive Vergence formula is based mainly, it's dependent on the preoperative refraction, and of course the manufacturer's IOL constant. It's very useful for the calculation of IOL power in phakic IOLs, secondary IOLs, and the piggyback lenses. The various formulas are there, but holiday R stands for refractive Vergence, is good among these. And this, in 1993, Jack Holliday proposed this formula, which still holds good. And this is the press by pre-operative refraction, and this is the desired post-operative refraction. So based on this, and the ELP, we can calculate the lens power. And this has been shown by Dr. Arup in his presentation. So this is from Dr. Hill's website, where as you see, the IOL as it is shifted from bag to sulcus, so the power changes. The higher the IOL power that is required for the in the bag implantation, the subtraction has to be more. So, as you see, as the power comes down, the required subtraction also comes down. So, this is to summarize these two slides. See, if you have power between 25.5 and 30 diopters, because that is the maximum lens power that is calculated that is available in most of the regular, in the regular range, power range, in most of the companies. So around 1.5 you'll have to subtract for sulcus adjustment, and from 15.5 to 25.5 is around minus 1, and then 0.5 for 8.5 to 15, anything less than 8, we don't need to correct it. So this is one thing, and this is another guideline, rough guideline, for calculating. Say, to keep it in sulcus, you subtract 1, keep it in AC, subtract 2, like that. But again, so the A constant also changes, so the manufacturer's A constant, where AC lenses, this is what we used to do earlier, subtract from the IOL bag in the bag and the sulcus lens power calculation, and then implant the lenses. There also we used to get reasonably good results. All said and done, sometimes there can be surprises of about 0.5 to 1 diopter. You may not be able to hit exactly the emmetropic value. So now coming to the second topic, that is the piggyback IOLs. In fact, this is now very very commonly we are discussing about it. There are various other names for this. You can supplementary IOL, add-on IOL, or polysaccharide. It can be used as a primary option in a very high hyperopes, though where you have to place one lens in the bag and one lens in the sulcus. But now we can get customized IOLs also. For example, K Group is making one. Or we can use it as a good option in pediatric aphakic management, where, but I'll come to this a little later. and it's probably it's a better option. Then we can use it in post-op refractive surfaces as a secondary level option. So for example, in high hyperopia, how do we go about calculating the power? First, calculate the power using all the latest formulas that are available for the calculation of the hypermobile short eyes that is required for in the bag implantation to achieve emmetropia, and then divide the power into in the bag and then in the sulcus. So whatever that maximum lens power that is available, you can place in the bag and the remaining in the sulcus, and then calculate the IOL power of the sulcus lens. So based on, so this is how we can go about it. This is an example I have taken directly from the Dr. Hill website. So where this is one example where suppose say left eye is dominant, it requires about plus 46 to achieve emmetropia, and then to get around minus 0.75 in the non-dominant eye, around 47 diopters. So this is the total power that is required, but lens available is around 30. So all that we need is around plus 17 or plus 16 to be placed in the bag to achieve this thing. But in the sulcus, you have to subtract, use the subtraction factor, and then finally achieve the lens that is to be implanted in the sulcus, say around plus 16 and plus 15. So the lens that is to be implanted in the bag is around plus 30 and plus 16 in the sulcus. So now what kind of lens that you can use? You can place the regular lens in the bag, and in the ciliary sulcus, a large diameter, low profile with round edge, and the large diameter because up to 7 millimeters also you can go here. Usually what we are getting is hydrophilic lenses, but you can use hydrophobic also. And this is in pediatric aphakia, about 20% can be placed in the sulcus, so that once it reaches non-treatable limits, like we can't correct with the glasses, then you can remove the lens. This is how you can achieve emmetropia from the beginning. Then secondary piggyback IOLs, which my friend is going to tackle in detail. This is for the post-cataract surgery refractive error. All that you need to know is refractive error, and you don't need to know what lens has been implanted in the bag. All that we need to know is whether it is placed in the sulcus or in the bag. If it is placed in the sulcus, then you'll have to choose other options. And the IOL power that is calculated is like this, myopic error into 1.2 and the hyperopic error, so this is the pre-op error, into 1.5. So these are the lenses available with us, but I mean in the world, but what we have is more commonly sulcoflex, and now the care group is coming out with this. I have no financial interest in any of these products. All that you have to give for the calculation is the refractive error, but this particular lens requires the keratometry, axial length, as well as white-to-white measurement to calculate. So the secondary IOL power is calculated as per the regular formula, and the adjustment in power are made according to changes in the effective lens position. Piggyback IOL is based on refractive error. So thank you very much for your.
Thank you so much, Satyamurthy. It was actually quite a vast topic, and you did so well. And for your next speaker, of course, is Kumar, and he's going to talk about the extremes of axial length. See, all these sessions are being recorded. So because of time constraints, we may not be able to really have a good and a very active discussion. So you can review the videos, and if you have any issues, any questions or any suggestions to be made, you can contact us. I think that is one way, provided if we don't have much time for discussion at the end of the session today. And till Kumar comes on stage, any questions for Satyamurthy? So regarding the bag sulcus conversion, the algorithm, the rough rule of thumb is 5%. If you have calculated the bag power, you reduce the IOL power by 5% if you are going to keep the lens in the sulcus. But then you should not use a single piece hydrophobic acrylic lens in the sulcus. So that also has to be kept in the mind. So a bag power for a sulcus for a 3-piece hydrophobic IOL should be calculated, and then you deduct 5% from that. So that has to be kept in your mind. Kumar, are you ready?
Just clear up the previous confusion.
Yeah, please, go ahead.
Barrett TrueK is a different formula. Barrett Torii calculator is a different formula. And in all these cases, what you use normally is your anterior corneal values. There, but with the advent of the IOL Master 700, only if you have an IOL Master 700 in your place, then you can think of Barrett Toric TK, Barrett Universal 2 TK. TK is not the same as TrueK. TK stands for total keratometry, where the Barrett formula makes an adjustment for the in the nomogram itself. There you can click on measured posterior corneal elastic meristem instead of predicted posterior corneal elastic meristem. Now there are various studies which compare Barrett toric TK to Barrett normal toric formula, and some have found an advantage, some have found both of them to be equal. So the jury is still out on that, but only think of TK if you have an IOL Master 700, otherwise forget about it.
So Kumar, can we have your